Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Marinos Themistocleos. I am director at the Institute of the Future for the Future at the University of Nicosia. I'm also the associate dean at the School of Business at the same university. My presentation aims basically to explain the different types of disruption we have in banking. But before going into the actual thing, please allow me to say a few words about the University of Nicosia. The University of Nicosia is the largest university in Cyprus. We have more than 12,000 students who attend various classes in many different fields, ranging from medical studies, business studies, social sciences, engineering, computer science, and so on. And our motto here at the University of Nicosia is the excellence in education. And we demonstrate this through various ways. One of them is through our programs, and one of the most successful programs we have in the University of Nicosia is the MSc in Blockchain and Digital Currency, which is was launched basically in 2014. It was the first one that was launched on blockchain technology. And it is consistently ranked at the top position in various different articles and media like CoinDesk, the Medium, the Merkle, or even the Invest.com. In addition to this, we have a lot of recognition and support from the industry. For instance, Ripple offers collaborates with us. Ripple is one of the biggest companies in the area of blockchain, and they support our MSc studies by offering scholarships. Coinbase, which is one of the biggest exchange in cryptos, they also offer for this September only four sponsorships starting in fall 2021. So we have this support from the industry. And of course, we also demonstrate our excellence through various activities, including also research, either working with the industry, like Ripple. I mentioned before, Ripple, we have a close relationship with Stellar, and we're doing a lot of work for Stellar, and also we're consultants, and we're among the few organizations in Europe that consult the European Union on blockchain technology. We participate on the European Blockchain Observatory Forum, and we provide reports and information on blockchain technology. We're going to publish more or less 30 reports. The last one that was published earlier this month is on CBDCs, and we also advise the European blockchain, the European Union, in terms of the technical aspects of blockchain technology, and we help them to build the European blockchain service infrastructure. So one of the programs we offer, as I said, is the MSc in Blockchain and Digital Currency. This is the duration of the studies are 3 semesters, but someone can take the degree in one calendar year. It combines, for instance, the MSc thesis during the summertime. The program is offered in two modes, in both distance learning and conventional mode on campus. And this is a brief outline of our program. As you can see, we believe that blockchain technology is a multidisciplinary area which combines fields from various domains, including computer science, business studies, law and regulation, and so on. For that reason, we offer different pathways, and one pathway we offer is software engineering. Someone can go through this path by selecting electives that focus on programming, like digital currency programming, smart contract programming, permission, blockchain programming, or cryptographic system security, or can go into a more business-oriented one by selecting electives ranging from token economics, fintech, decentralized finance, or emerging law and regulation. We have students coming from more than 35 countries around the globe. The first course of this program is a free online course, and till now it has attracted more than 45,000 participants from around 110 countries around the globe. We think that the program is very, very successful, and we can tell this by having a look to the employability prospects of our graduates on one hand. On the other hand, we can say this because we can see that 54% of our graduates change their profession to a more blockchain related one. So this shows that the program has an impact on their studies and their intention to proceed with that technology too. If you have more inquiries on the Rollingmines, please contact my colleague Hazal Alpinal, who is also joined the booth of our university in this Arab M-Tech conference. Also, for the purpose of this conference, we offer a 15% discount to the participants of this conference who would like to join our MSc program, either online or on campus, starting from fall 2021. So please contact, feel free to contact Hazal for any information by email. The email is aribinar.h@unique.ac.cy. Now, let's move into the blockchain disruption in banking. In my point of view, I can see five different areas of disruption regarding blockchain and cryptocurrency in the banking sector. We can talk here about disruption in areas like money, assets, and market, settlement banks disruption, and of course, the disruption in the banking sector. Let me start by exploring one by one all these different areas of disruption. Let's start with the new forms of money and the fact that the digital currency disrupts a lot the banking sector and the payments. As you know, digital currency is money from the network, money that is produced by computers based on a common agreed consensus algorithm shared on a peer-to-peer environment. And all this allow us to have a new form of money, money that is programmable, money that is active. And of course, this money can be suitable for machines, not only because we have nano quantities of currency that we use, but also because we can convert this digital money into transactions that can run through machines, through computers. For instance, you can have at your house installed, let's say, a solar panel, and you can connect it with a smart battery. The battery can have embedded IoT, AI, artificial intelligence, blockchain, digital wallet, and so on. So at the end of the day, this convergence of these technologies, the convergence of AI, IoT, blockchain technology, etc., can function as an advanced application that can communicate with the smart grid and discharge the energy to the smart grid. In this way, you can sell your energy at the best price because the algorithm can tell you when is the right moment to sell your energy. So you can have the best performance and you can do your transactions without any problems. And of course, all of that without your intervention. This is not science fiction. This is something that happens. We developed such an application 2-3 years ago here at the university. So similarly, there are many other similar applications that emphasize on machine-to-machine commerce using blockchain technology. So cryptocurrencies and blockchain technology is not a fad, and we can tell so by having a look to the capitalization that we have in terms of cryptocurrency, which is more or less around $2 trillion US dollars. Many people believe that Bitcoin is the only kind of digital currency, but apparently it seems that we have more than 4 to 5 or maybe more thousands of cryptocurrencies today, ranging from Bitcoin, Ethereum, or Ripple, and many others. And of course, we can classify them into different types. We can talk about cryptocurrencies, about stable coins, which they don't have this volatility compared to the cryptocurrencies. Tether is an example of this. We can talk about fungible tokens or non-fungible tokens, NFTs, that are very trendy these days. Or more recently, we can talk about central bank digital currencies like the cent dollar that was published by the Central Bank of Bahamas in October 2020. So the question is, what's next? What's going to come in the next year? Clearly, we can see that there is a huge disruption of blockchain technology and digital currency in the area of money. And we can see that the big issue here, one of the big issues we have it relates basically to the adoption of, or the mass adoption of this technology and this new form of money. We recently saw very, very good news, positive news coming from the market. That this is an article that was published around 10 days ago, and it says that El Salvador looks to become the first country in the world to adopt Bitcoin as a legal tender. So we can see countries that are thinking, or they're in the procedure to move towards that direction. Someone may say that, you know, something, El Salvador does not have a strong economy, or this country has issues, et cetera, et cetera. On the other hand, it gives the local people, it gives its own citizens the opportunity to come closer to the crypto community, to the cryptocurrency, basically, and use them as an alternative. And all this, on the top of the fact that 70% of the people of El Salvador today are unbanked. So they don't have a bank account, and this is a big amount of the population. And therefore, using some kind of a cryptocurrency like Bitcoin, this may be beneficial for them in sending remittances or receiving remittances from abroad, or doing business through this new cryptocurrency. But since the discussions about disruption, not only good things happen, but also we can see some reservations from various organizations, and one of them is IMF. IMF, as this article says, it sees risk after El Salvador so makes Bitcoin legal tender. And this shows that some organizations, central banks, the banking system itself is a bit reluctant for various reasons. And also we can see, again, on this article at the bottom, which was published again a couple of days ago, that some officials from the Dutch, from Holland, basically, they called for a complete ban on Bitcoin. And apparently this is published next to another interesting article, which says basically that over 2 million adults in UK now hold crypto. So the one says go and ban crypto. The other part of the same page, of the same, on the next column of the same page, it says, you know something, society really trusts cryptos, and we have millions of people in UK only that have adopted this new technology. So the question is how fast and how far away are we going? And I think it's relevant to report this tweet that was published 2 days ago by Charlie Schrem, who says, you know something, in 2010, nobody uses Bitcoin. Then we start saying only computer geeks use blockchain technology and cryptocurrencies. Then we start saying that only drug dealers use it, or money launderers, or gamblers. In 2018, actually, someone said now Bitcoin is dead because we had that dramatic reduce of the price in the early 2018. And then again, in 2018, they start saying that a small percentage of the population use it, a small companies use it. It was in 2020 and 2021, only small countries use it. In my eyes, all this show that there is a lot of resistance to change, and we try to create obstacles not to adopt the technology or not to adopt the crypto. And the time will solve the problem, I think, and the same thing happened with many other technologies. So sooner or later, I think we will see medium-sized countries adopting cryptocurrencies, or innovative countries adopting cryptocurrencies, and then big countries and so on. And therefore, the situation it takes time to achieve mass adoption. We need to solve other problems we have in the area, like scalability, interoperability, and so on, technical problems, etc. But on the other hand, I think the community will slowly go ahead and adopt the cryptos and the technology, despite the problems we have. Now, the second area of disruption is a disruption that we have in the banking sector, and here I can see 9 different ways that blockchain technology disrupts the banking sector. We can talk here about cross-border transactions, like the case of Santander, where this bank has introduced cross-border transactions and managed to reduce the time for completing the transactions on one hand, and and on the other hand, it reduced also the cost. In terms of transactions, like the example of the Chinese Construction Bank, where it managed to achieve faster and cheaper transactions. Smart contracts enforcement, this is a big disruption we have in the market, and with the case like the one presented by JP Morgan Chase, we managed to eliminate commercial contract disputes because everything now is controlled by computers. The decisions are made based on the contract, which is digitally, let's say, controlled, and decision making is based on the whether we meet specific criteria or not. Cryptocurrency financial management services is another huge issue here. We can see that for many years, the traditional players in the banking sector refused to go ahead and support the market, support the crypto society with applications that can support them in buying and selling cryptos. And therefore, we had new players that have evolved in the market, like Revolut, Kraken, Monice, Hybe, or Simple, or many other. And of course, here we can say that there are endless opportunities and a whole new market that is in front of us. Record sharing, or in another category, we also have AML and Know Your Client, Know Your Customer. Both are developed, I mean, solutions are developed by many organizations. An example is the applications developed by the Bank of America, where they managed to cut the cost by 50% in terms of Know Your Customer. And of course, this brings a lot of benefits to the regulators too. Regarding the record sharing and storage, we can have transparency. We can see that there is a huge cost savings because of the actions that we're doing on the blockchain. And we're talking about $8 to $12 billion per annum. And of course, we have immutability. We cannot change the records. Once the records are in, then everything is sorted and is done. And I mentioned before, Servicio del Banco with the case of El Salvador, but it's not the only case where we have a big percentage of the population that is unbanked. We have around 2.5 billion people, adults people, unbanked around the globe, the world. And financial inclusion is a huge issue and a huge target here that we need to work on and achieve. Recently, we saw that the European Investment Bank had moved ahead and issued bonds using blockchain technology. And also, DeFi can disrupt the market in terms of fundraising, not only in fundraising, but just for example, here I'm mentioning fundraising, and we can see endless number of organizations who raise money through this new type. One of the more successful in our area, for instance, is Ethereum. Okay. In this slide, we can see with the bullet points banks in Europe that offer crypto banking services, like the Solaris Bank in Germany or Sparkasse in Germany. And what we observe is that not all the European countries have worked at the same level to convert their traditional banks to offer services, custodian services to their customers. We can see that there is effort put by few countries like Germany, Switzerland, Lithuania, Malta, UK, and some others like Liechtenstein and Estonia, but the rest of the other countries are behind this this first group of countries that work on converting their traditional banks and offer custodian services. What else we see in this slide is that at the bottom we have locals from other banks in not only based in Europe but abroad, like the Ally Bank in the United States of America, the USSA, Barclays, the National Bank of Canada, Goldman Sachs, and other that have moved and have entered into that area, which is very, very promising and very supporting for them, for the community. And also we can see to the right of the screen, new players that they never had in mind to become a bank, a digital bank. And now we can see Revolut, Kraken, Change, Monice, or Simple, and many, many others that have become neobank or crypto banking organizations supporting both the crypto transactions, but also traditional banking services. So here we can see a real new disruption because on one hand, we have the traditional players that are trying slowly to catch up with the competition. And the competition is imposed basically by the new players, the new that we have at the right side of this screen. And I'm not sure what's the situation in the United Arab Emirates regarding the commercial banks. I've done some research on the net. I haven't found anything notable. So I think it's good to have a look there in this area. I mean, this is a huge market with a lot of potential. And the sooner the banks, the traditional banks, join this market, the better for them, because on one hand, the practice has shown that the first mover gains a lot of advantage compared to the followers. A third area of disruption is the fact that cryptocurrency can be seen as a new asset class. And this is an asset class that is very profitable for many organizations. Please note that I'm not going to give you an investment advice, but I'm just presenting the data as a collecting from the net. And as a researcher, as an academic, etc., what I do, I just read the data and I'm not giving you any kind of advice. So what we see here to the left of the screen, we can see the price for the Bitcoin. This is the upper left screen, basically, which shows that it started from zero US dollar back in 2009 and moves steadily increases its price. So these are real data. Of course, we had up and downs, we had volatility. Sometimes volatility was very high or etc. But in any way, if you see this snapshot, you can see a clear trend that we start from zero and it grows with some correction, but it grows. This is the what I see on the screen. And we also see that the volume of transactions has also increased, which again is a positive message. Now, since that was the situation, and not only myself, but many other organizations have seen what I just mentioned before, so they are trying to change their investments in terms of the treasury investments and their strategies. So we can see that many organizations today try to change their percentage of their stocks, bonds, to allow them to introduce also either investments in Bitcoin or in other top 10 crypto. So what we see in this table here is a type of strategy we have, the distribution between stocks, bonds, Bitcoin, crypto, and the best performance or Sharpe ratio in another language, or the worst performance. So in a typical scenario, when usually invest 60% of their treasury to stocks and the rest to bonds, they usually have a best performance of 67.6%. And the outcome is the worst case scenario is to lose around 21.64%. Now, if we progressively start introducing part of their portfolio to include also cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin, we can have the conservative, the moderate, or the crypto-friendly scenario. And if you take the crypto-friendly, all of them, you can see that every time we increase the amount of cryptos we have, the performance becomes better and better. And if you have a look to the last, the data we have for the last 10, 11 years regarding the performance of assets, you can see that Bitcoin has been the best performing asset for the last 11 years. Actually, it was ranked in the first position out of 11 years. So we can see that progressively, all these strategies here show a huge, let's say, increment in performance in case we invest in Bitcoin or crypto 10, the best crypto 10 currencies we have. And on the other hand, we can see that the worst performance, it remains more or less the same, but in a better, let's say, actual result for the crypto investments. So it's around minus 21, but it's almost there, nothing else. It doesn't go, it also reduces for some decimals. So this situation was well recognized by many organizations that they have started their investments in this area. So we can see that one of the first organizations that became known about its strategies, the MicroStrategy, the A company, MicroStrategy, that have invested around initially $425 million in US dollars. Later on, they invested more money, ranging to $1 billion. Now they have much more. We also saw many, many other organizations. And have a look here. It's again another tweet from MicroStrategy this time. It's dated back in October 21st, 2020. And what they say basically is that in a couple of weeks, they managed to increase their profit by $41 billion, which is not bad at all. Now, what MicroStrategy does is to announce a couple of days ago that they're going to ask the support of the people to raise money, a lot of money. And with this money, they are going to buy Bitcoins. And then at the end of the day, when there will be profit, they will give back to those they want back their money, or, you know, with the percentage of the profit, et cetera, et cetera. So again, it's a nice strategy having other people paying you to invest in cryptocurrencies. And then at the end of the day, when you give back the money, you keep a percentage of this amount. So what it does basically is progressively converted into an intermediary as an investor in Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies. So it's another kind of disruption that we can slowly see that is going to happen. And we may see many other organizations doing the same, not functioning in the traditional banking or investments sector. Fourth disruption is obviously the central bank digital currency. What we see in this figure that comes from the BIS, the Bank of International Settlement, it's a survey published by BIS a couple of months ago, basically shows that around 80%, 86% of the total central banks around the globe have done some kind of work in regards to the cryptocurrencies, and they focus basically on two different areas, the retail CBDCs and the wholesale CBDCs. Now, we can also observe some differences in terms of the type of the CBDC, but also on the type of the country. And in this figure here, we can see that the more advanced countries, the AE, have almost similar performance or motivations with the less developed countries in regard to payments, payment safety, others, or financial stability. We can see clearly a difference in terms of monetary policy implementation, financial inclusion, or payment efficiency, because basically of the financial stability and the status of each country. We cannot compare, for instance, the United States of America or the Eurozone with a country like, who is a less developed country in Africa or somewhere else.
Professor, sorry to interrupt you, but we are running out of time because we have another question. So, I should wrap up. Thank you for your valuable information.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I'm going to wrap up by giving you another one slide, just to say that the fifth disruption is by new players that shake up the ecosystem. So we can see new players that have nothing to do with the entire banking sector, like Facebook, that are issuing their cryptos or planning to issue their cryptos, and this will have a huge impact in the market. It already had by influencing regulators or central banks to do a lot of work. Or we can see some other who support the banking sector in other ways, like PayPal and MasterCard, but they're also entering in this space too. Thank you so much for attending this presentation, and good luck. If you want to send me your question, I'll be glad to answer. Use my email address.
This session is recorded, and it will be posted on social media, so then later people can also attend and watch it. Thank you so much for your time. Bye.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.